How dangerous is the Delta variant? Do vaccines remain protective against Delta? Why are fully vaccinated people still transmitting the virus? And what can be done to slow viral evolution? Hi, and welcome to Microbial Minutes. This is the American Society for Microbiology's update on what's hot in the microbial sciences. I'm Ashley Hagen, Science Communications Specialist for ASM. And today we're talking about Delta, the SARS-CoV-2 variant first identified in India in December of 2020 that became the dominant variant of SARS-CoV-2 worldwide in a matter of months and prompted the CDC to recommend masking in indoor public spaces regardless of vaccination status in areas where COVID-19 transmission is high. Recent surges of COVID-19 as a result of Delta's rapid spread have caused mixed feelings of discouragement, fear, and denial across the globe. Healthcare workers are once again feeling the strain as hospitals are flooded with COVID-19 cases, and people are questioning whether vaccines are still working. And if so, why we need to wear masks again? Today, we're going to dig into research that will help address those questions. Studies like this preprint from the UK show that while two doses of vaccines are effective at preventing severe disease, hospitalization, and death caused by Delta, vaccinated sera display lower levels of neutralization against the Delta variant compared to the original strain. A study published in the New England Journal of Medicine tested the neutralization activity of sera from individuals who had recovered from natural SARS-CoV-2 infection and individuals who had been fully vaccinated with Moderna or Pfizer vaccines against infectious Delta virus, and found that on average, Delta was 2.9 times less susceptible to neutralization than the Wuhan strain. But all vaccination serum samples showed detectable neutralization activity, and researchers concluded that immunity conferred by mRNA vaccines is likely to be retained against Delta. Still, because no vaccine is 100% effective, a small percentage of people who are fully vaccinated may become infected with SARS-CoV-2. On the whole, instances when fully vaccinated individuals become infected with SARS-CoV-2 are rare. But the CDC transitioned from measuring all breakthrough infections to only measuring those that result in hospitalization or death on May 1st of 2021. So the frequency of breakthrough cases that result in mild to moderate disease remains unknown. But recent outbreaks suggest that the incidence of breakthrough infection may be higher with Delta. Genomic analysis of isolates from 677 vaccine breakthrough infections in India revealed that Delta was the predominant lineage in groups who were partially and fully vaccinated with either AstraZeneca or Covaxin. And on July 30th, an early release of the CDC's Morbidity and Mortality Weekly Report stated that approximately 3/4 of the 469 SARS-CoV-2 cases from an outbreak associated with large public gatherings in Barnstable County, Massachusetts, occurred in fully vaccinated individuals. 90% of the 133 specimens that were sequenced were identified as the Delta variant. 5 patients were hospitalized, 4 of them fully vaccinated. Furthermore, the CT values of samples taken from vaccinated and unvaccinated individuals were found to be similar, with a median of 22.77 for vaccinated and 21.54 for unvaccinated populations. Although not necessarily directly related to viral load, CT values may provide a crude correlation to the amount of virus that is present in a sample, and these results suggested that vaccinated people are still capable of transmitting the virus. In an effort to better understand the virological and serological kinetics of breakthrough infections, scientists performed a multi-center retrospective cohort study of 218 hospitalized patients who were diagnosed with Delta SARS-CoV-2 infection in Singapore. 84 of those patients had received at least one dose of mRNA vaccine, and 71 were fully vaccinated. Vaccine breakthrough occurred more frequently in older patients with a median age range of 56 years for breakthrough infections. Additionally, vaccinated patients were more likely to be asymptomatic or have mild symptoms of COVID-19, while unvaccinated individuals had worse levels of biomarkers associated with severe COVID-19 and were more likely to develop pneumonia and require supplementary oxygen and ICU admission. CT values were once again analyzed as the surrogate marker for viral load and found to not be significantly different between vaccinated and unvaccinated populations, 19.2 versus 18.8. However, vaccinated individuals showed a faster increase in CT value over time, which researchers suggested was representative of a more rapid decline in viral load. Anti-spike antibodies were rapidly boosted early in infection for vaccinated individuals. However, the antibody titers were significantly lower against Delta than the original strain. since it has been clearly demonstrated that vaccines are highly effective at preventing severe disease related to the Delta variant. The question remains, why are vaccinated individuals still able to transmit SARS-CoV-2? Studies indicate that the answer may lie at least in part with mucosal immunity. All vaccines against COVID-19 that are currently in distribution focus on systemic injection, with the ultimate goal of inducing circulatory IgG antibodies and cytotoxic T cells, which are very successful at preventing severe disease caused by infection in the lungs and lower respiratory tract. But SARS-CoV-2 is contracted through mucosal surfaces of the nose and mouth. And complete prevention of infection, or sterilizing immunity, can only be achieved if immune cells also reach the mucosal surfaces of the upper respiratory tract where the virus finds its point of entry. Studies like this preprint have detected anti-spike, anti-RBD IgG antibodies in the saliva of patients who received an mRNA vaccine by intramuscular injection. Furthermore, salivary IgG titers increased after 2 doses of vaccine, leading scientists to suspect that current vaccines induce high enough levels of circulating antibodies that some of them do end up in the mucous membranes of the nose and throat. However, these antibodies have been shown to wane over time, and early nasal protection appears to only be temporary. The study also identified spike-specific secretory IgA antibodies in the saliva of nearly all vaccinated participants after 1 dose of mRNA vaccine. But these antibodies began to wane after the 2nd dose of vaccine, indicating that any antigen-specific SIgA response generated via intramuscular injection is compartmentalized and also transient. Because current vaccines are not likely to produce robust protection from SARS-CoV-2 in the upper respiratory tract, especially for infections caused by Delta, which have been reported to have viral loads of approximately 1,000 times higher than infections caused by other variants, scientists are investigating mucosal routes of immunization, including intranasal injection. Bharat, the makers of Covaxin, have developed an intranasal vaccine that became the first of its kind to receive regulatory approval to move on to phase 2 and 3 trials. AstraZeneca is also working on an intranasal version of the SARS-CoV-2 vaccine that the company developed with the University of Oxford. And another intranasal candidate vaccine called CVX-GA1, built using parainfluenza virus 5 expressing the SARS-CoV-2 S protein, is currently in the recruiting stage of phase 1 clinical trials. Still, there are challenges when it comes to intranasal vaccine design, including the fact that historically speaking, intranasal vaccines that do not use live virus to trigger immune responses have not been particularly successful. Introducing live virus to trigger an immune response without causing full-blown infection is a delicate balance, and some scientists believe this is an unnecessary hurdle to clear, since current vaccines are so highly effective at preventing the worst outcomes of SARS-CoV-2 infection, including severe disease, hospitalization, and death. Taken together, this data help explain why masking can reduce transmission of the SARS-CoV-2 virus through the nose and mouth, and why wearing a mask is especially prudent in areas where community transmission is high, which according to the CDC is now over 90% of counties in the United States. It's critical to understand how and why new SARS-CoV-2 variants continue to evolve. The virus continues to accrue variations in its genome due to simple replication errors. However, selective pressure is undoubtedly driving natural selection. In this race for survival of the fittest, Delta, which the World Health Organization has called the fastest and fittest variant so far, has given the virus an edge. Thanks to a series of mutations in the spike protein, the portion of the virus that binds to human ACE2 receptors and mediates viral entry, Delta is 40 to 60% more transmissible than Alpha, and almost twice as transmissible as the original Wuhan strain. The key is to get ahead of the natural selection that's occurring. If we want to stop SARS-CoV-2 from continuing to evolve and spread, we need to simultaneously reduce case numbers and increase immunity. So here are a few key takeaways from today's session about the SARS-CoV-2 Delta variant and mucosal immunity. The Delta variant is 40 to 60% more transmissible than Alpha and almost twice as transmissible as the original Wuhan strain. Vaccines remain highly effective at preventing hospitalization and death from Delta infection, but data indicate that vaccinated individuals may still be able to transmit the virus. This is due in part to the generation of insufficient mucosal immunity via systemic injection to remain protective over time. Mucosal routes of immunization are under investigation, with a number of intranasal vaccines entering clinical trial. In combination, vaccination and masking can reduce the risk of severe disease, slow transmission, and reduce the evolution of SARS-CoV-2. So that's the latest in what's hot in the microbial sciences. As always, it's important to remember that this data is preliminary, and new information about Delta is being produced daily. So keep seeking new and reputable sources. And don't forget to subscribe to ASM's YouTube channel and ring the bell for notifications every time we have a Microbial Minutes update. I'm Ashley Hagen. I'd like to thank you for watching and thank Ray Ortega for production. I'll talk to you next time.